everybody. I'm Bill Cott. Some of you might know me from the Ambiguously Gay Duo on Saturday Night Live or the Dana Carvey Show, where those sketches started out. And with me here today is Eric Hoffman.
Hello. I'm Eric Hoffman. I'm a writer, goof off. You've seen me in, Mr. Show and written a movie or two, Girlfriend's Day on Netflix. And Bill and I, of course, have been sketch partners, comedy partners for quite a few years now. And we're just happy to be here and kind of shoot the crap about some sketch stuff.
Yeah. I just did the math on that. I think it's over 20 years.
Yeah, it has to be. Yeah.
Bell Twist was around 2001 or so. Maybe even earlier than that.
Scared. I think it was. Yeah. Yeah, I think it was late 90s we got going, 1999.
Speaking of history, you've done a little bit of research on the history of commercial parody. So do you want to go over a little bit of that with us?
I did a little. You know, commercial parodies can sometimes, I think, be a little like political humor in that they're sort of easily dated sometimes, you know. Like Ike jokes, of course, Gerald Ford jokes, they don't really hold up too well usually. But for me, you know, if a performance is there, if it's really noteworthy, then crazy products are always going to be around. And they'll need to be sold. And the style that it's shot in and presented in can change, but the basic idea, you know, that we're trying to sell some crappy product, I believe, is evergreen, as they say. And there's different types of commercials, household products, clothing, cars. There's also movie trailer commercials, PSAs, public service announcements, infomercials, political ads. But anyway, here's the unofficial history of commercial parody as far as I've been able to find. Now, the first one, I'm sure, you know, of course, Bill Shakespeare probably invented it. But the first one that I've been able to find, the first one that kind of made an impression is a routine called Guzzler's Gin, which was a commercial parody made famous by comedian Red Skelton in vaudeville, of all places, in 1935. And at the time, it was set up as a radio commercial, wherein, if you've never seen it, the commercial presenter, which was Red Skelton, who wasn't a drinker, would have to keep taking samples of the product for each commercial break. And eventually, you know, he would get progressively drunker with each break until he could barely stand up. He kept saying, smooth. And of course, the smooth would get ever more less smooth. And there were no liquor ads on radio after 1936. So my guess is that it was kind of based on the format of a typical ad where an announcer would sample the product throughout a show or something. Only they made it funny by making the product alcohol. As near as I can tell, it was probably written by Red Skelton and his first wife, Edna Stillwell, who collaborated with him on his early routines and got them all shaped up. And although I did see one account where it was credited to a vaudevillian named James Barton, who supposedly taught it to Skelton. And there were other comedians that did variations of this kind of thing through the 30s and 40s, but Skelton is the one who kind of made it his own, kind of like Abbott and Costello did with Who's On First. And of course, we all remember probably Lucille Ball later did a famous version of this on her sitcom, I Love Lucy, which was called Vetamita Vegemin. That's what it was.
You're pronouncing it the way she pronounced it after three drinks.
Well, I've been nipping in the and so briefly, real quick, with the Guzzler's Gin, as I said, it started off in vaudeville, but the first place that the masses could actually see it, it was filmed for a movie called Ziegfeld Follies in 1945. Interestingly enough, it was renamed. It wasn't just called Guzzler's Gin. It was called When Television Comes. There was a title card that says, Red Skelton will now show you what happens when television comes. I guess they were just trying to explain why it was visual for a radio thing. But it's just funny because later on, even when he had his TV show, when he would do the routine, he would still introduce it as a radio commercial. Weird. So from there, it gets a little sketchy. I'm sure that some other people, you know, would spoof commercials, but nothing really you know, there wasn't like any regular show where that was a regular feature, you know, where they would satirize or parody commercials that were going on. And I wonder if that wasn't kind of a part of a fear of legal action, because in the 50s, they had just declared in a court trial that shows like the Jack Benny Show and Your Show of Shows, shows like that, they could actually parody new movies that were just being released, and it wasn't considered copyright infringement. So parody in television at the time was kind of a, you know, an iffy thing, a new thing. So the next thing that I could find was print ads in Mad, which at the time was a comic book. It wasn't Mad Magazine. And the first thing that they did was in 1954, it was a takeoff on the Rheingold beer campaign called Potgold Beer. And then Johnny Carson, of course, in the 60s was doing a character called Art Fern, who would sell inane products. But, and there were things here and there on television, but the commercial parody as we know it today, from what I've been able to see, first came into its own in the 70s with SNL, or as I like to call it, Saturday Night Live. The first season had Shimmer, if you recall, which was a floor wax and a dessert topping. And they had Little Chocolate Donuts with John Belushi, which kind of tied with another one for my top three. But that kind of brings us up to today. Of course, you know, every sketch show and, you know, late night talk show really has been doing commercial parodies since the 70s. You know, that really, SNL, I think, really kicked off a wave of those. And they really do, I still think they do some of the best commercial parodies there are, because I mean, they just got great writers, a great cast and production values. They can make things look like the commercials they're parodying, which is kind of Mr. Show, I think, kind of started that cinematic approach to commercial. The commercials were doing at the time, they're the first ones to really kind of parody that element of it. That's my brief history of commercial parody. I'm standing by it.
Awesome. It occurred to me as you were talking about that even parodying their own commercials has been a form of parody for a lot of products that kind of picked up more steam with the cynicism of the 60s and the late 60s, but also even occurred in early radio on the Jack Benny program. Their sponsor was Jell-O. And every time Dennis would come on and start talking about Jell-O, it would be a joke about how much of a commercial inside of a program it was.
That's great.
And then I was thinking of Stan Freeberg, who started out as a Madison Avenue ad writer and worked his way into comedy as a result of that, making fun of some of his own ads. So I guess now we're starting with our countdown.
This is the big countdown, folks.
Here we go. Hope you're ready. My very first one was, of course, Saturday Night Live was one of my first loves. And this particular parody, it wasn't necessarily parodying a particular product, but it was in the early days of Saturday Night Live, an Eddie Murphy sketch that was called The Velvet Jones Institute of Technology. I Want to Be a Ho. Right. And it was created, obviously, by Eddie Murphy, but also with Robin Duke and Margaret Oberman, who were two earlier women who were hired to write on that show. At that point, more and more women started coming on board to write on Saturday Night Live. Still not enough. But those were some of the early days. And so they were kind of messing around, and they brought that idea to David Sheffield and Barry Blaustein, who actually directed me in the movie, The Ringer. And they came up with the very first Velvet Jones commercial, which not many commercial parodies become a spinoff and become a callback and have a catchphrase in them that gets called back so many times, so much so that when Eddie Murphy recently hosted Saturday Night Live, he was expected to do a Velvet Jones sketch in which you can learn, if they really want to know deep down inside, that question is burning for their own personal career goals, if they want to be a hoe. So that is one of my very top three commercials. Eric?
In our nice edited smooth version, you'll be able to see this now. So why don't we act like we're coming out of just seeing it with a nice big laugh?
All right.
On three. One, two, three. That's a good one.
It's a classic.
All right. So my first one is also from SNL. And the timing of this couldn't have worked out better. I didn't actually, when I was thinking of this, wasn't even thinking about the time frame or the day that we were going to be close to here. But it's one that I believe was written by Tina Fey called Mom Jeans. And this one, this isn't kind of like yours. It's not a specific ad campaign that they're targeting here, I don't think. I think it's just, you know, jeans ads in general, except they're kind of injecting it with, you know, instead of the normal kind of people that we'd see in a jeans ad, they're putting suburban moms in their place and acting how a suburban mom would be if they were in a jeans ad. You know, the performances of this is what just makes it so funny for me. And it seems like it's a very evergreen kind of idea, you know? And I guess Tina Fey, from what I saw an interview with her, she got this idea where she, when she had gone out and purchased some clothing for herself and kind of noticed that, you know, it was bigger than she needed or whatever the thing was. And it happened to coincide with a writer's day at SNL. And she just thought, you know, maybe I can use this idea for something. So it's really funny. And of course, Tina Fey, Amy Poehler, Maya Rudolph, and Rachel Dratch are in this, and just hilarious. And let's check it out here.
And that's, of course, where we would be viewing it.
Right.
And now, hold on a second. Let me put it back in gallery view so they could see us laughing. And of course, Tina was not known for her sense of fashion as a young improviser.
Really?
And now we come to my second top commercial parody, and it's from one of my favorite shows of all time, SCTV. I think they did parody better than most other shows that I've ever seen, and they tended to pack a lot of programming into every single commercial. My favorite was Indira, which was a parody of the musical of Evita.
Evita.
And you know that they were parodying not just the musical, but the commercial itself, which if you lived on the East Coast in that time, and I did, we were in Pennsylvania, so we'd get all the Broadway commercials. It was a direct parody of the live Broadway commercial of Evita, only it was starring Indira Gandhi herself, as played by Andrea Martin, and Larity, who played the Che Guevara sort of a character. And it kind of combined Bollywood, Evita, and hokey Slim Whitman yodeling country music. And it was so popular on the show that it was used in its entirety in two different episodes in the half hour format, and then appeared in two 90-minute episodes later in the future. It appeared in the Godfather episode, and also in the version where they parodied Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It was seen in the cameras or the screens behind them in the programming room. So Indira had so much life on that program that it appeared in a total of four episodes of SCTV.
Any idea who may have written that?
I would assume that Joe Flaherty and Andrea Martin played a big hand in that.
Right.
But I wasn't able to track that one down exactly who had written it, but it was a huge collaborative process on SCTV because they were used to creating together as a unit at Second City Toronto. And so I would say since those two were featured more prominently in it, but also the head writer at that time was Dave Thomas. So I'm sure he had a hand in it as well.
All right, let's check it out.
This Saturday night only at the Akron Civic Arena, Indira Gandhi appears live on stage in her own life story, Indira.
Don't cry for me, Lord, for me.
You were supposed to
Also starring Slim Whitman as Punji Guevara.
I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. I kept my promise.
She was just a prime minister who wanted to become a singer, and nobody seemed to notice she simply seduced a nation. Watch for Indira when it comes to your area. July 17th, Toledo Sports Center. July 18th, Pickle Bills, Cleveland, Ohio. July 19th, Marty Allen's Town and Country Dinner Theater. July 20th, Nutty Nero's, Montebello, California. July 21st, Klondike Days, Edmonton, Alberta. July 22nd, Laughstop, Newport Beach. July 23rd, in North Hills, Allison Park. Johnny Garneau's Smorgasbord Theater featuring Don Brockett and Barbara Mazziati. July 24th, The Sizzler, Santa Fe, New Mexico. July 25th, 2 p.m., Matinee Performance, Queen Mary, Long Beach, California. July 26th, Don and Angie's Deep Ditch Pizza Theater, Glen Ellen, Illinois. And on July 27th, a special midnight performance at Lincoln Center, New York.
Very nice.
I'll never forget that one.
It's like I saw it for the first time yesterday.
Yeah.
So my second favorite commercial parody also comes from SNL. They're not all from SNL, so that's a little spoiler for you for my top favorite. As we mentioned, commercial parody kind of came into its own in the 70s with SNL. And one of the cast members that's kind of most remembered for that era is Dan Aykroyd. And he wrote and performed the infamous Bat-O-Matic sketch, which was a parody of the Ronco kitchen utensil commercials of the time. And, you know, Bat-O-Matic, of course, gets a lot of play. So I thought today we'd talk about one of the follow-ups to that. They did a lot of follow-ups based on that kind of format. One called Bat-O-Matic, which is basically Bat-O-Matic for Halloween. But this commercial just really, like all of these, plays into Aykroyd's strength of, you know, that rapid fire delivery of lists. Let's take a look at Dan Aykroyd, who I believe wrote it for Saturday Night Live. Bat-O-Matic.
Witches, warlocks, conjurers, sorcerers, black magicians, white magicians, are you having trouble mixing your potions in time for the winter solstice? Is your sorcery getting hung up because of the hours you spend mixing and blending your remedies? Then you need Ravco's amazing new witches aid, the Super Bat-O-Matic 77. You never have to use mortar, pestle, or cauldron again. Super Bat-O-Matic cuts, chops, slices, dices, mixes, and blends herbs, plants, twigs, sprigs, leaves, branches, claws, teeth, eyes, ears, skin, hair, blood, flies, insects, limbs, and organs of all kinds, toads, lizards, newts, mice, rats and bats faster than you can knife a goat. Take this 11th century remedy from the key of Alcazar. Potion to win love and shrink hives. Feather of a young hawk, belly of a fly, blood, bile of an ox, a lizard's lung. Say sarax, sarax, and your will is done. 7 threads of a hangman's garment, basil, wolfbane, and a shoot of wintermint. To this add the eye of a rat and mix in the body of one whole bat. Yes, mix in the body of one whole bat. Remember what a chore that used to be? Now it's fast and it's easy with Ronco's Bat-O-Matic. Here's how it works.
Wow, that's great bat and a great potion too. I'm in love and my hives are cured.
With Bat-O-Matic, you can prepare as many bat-based potions as you like without pounding, grinding, or mixing by hand. Throw away that mortar, pestle, and cauldron. Get the Super Bat-O-Matic 77. It works like magic.
Bat-O-Matic at alchemists everywhere.
I would never drink that in 1,000 years. Now I'd like to talk about, as I close out my trio, one of my favorite sketches of all time, and it's not from a television show. It was inside of a movie, and it was written by one of the best sketch writers of all time, Michael O'Donohue. At the very beginning of the movie Scrooged, we see the network promo, and we see their big upcoming project, The Night the Reindeer Died, with television's $6 million man as the hero of Santa's Workshop. And Michael O'Donohue had started off, you know, in underground theater and never really got the budget that he deserved. Even when writing on Saturday Night Live, he wasn't given the full filmic budget that a lot of his ideas deserved. And Scrooge kind of fulfilled his legacy. It allowed him to do the things that he wanted to do in like Mr. Mike's Mondo video, which included some commercial parodies and other work that he did. But that was the real capper for me. And of course, it's my wife's favorite Christmas movie. And that couldn't go without being said.
No, you're right. That is a classic. Yeah. Holiday classic.
It's my very special recipe.
Oh, we're not gonna make it if we don't hurry. You realize how late? I told you you're gonna break those toys.
Oh, wow, wait. Santa Claus, come quick. Look.
Incoming. Take cover. Majors, the $6 million band.
Santa, is there a back way out of this place?
Of course there is, Lee, but this is one Santa that's going out the front door.
Look, it don't matter a hill of beans what happens to me. The world couldn't afford it if anything happened to you. Now, you stay put.
Oh, that's very nice of you, Lee. And Lee, you've been a real good boy this year.
Yes, you sure have. Yeah.
7 o'clock, Psycho sees Santa's Workshop.
Eat this.
And only Lee Majors can stop them. The night the reindeer die. 8:30, and America's best loved singer invites you to share a home-style holiday. When it's Bob Goulet's old-fashioned Cajun Christmas. Ring-a-ling. 9 o'clock, IBC presents America's favorite family in a special Christmas episode.
Hi, Mom. Where's Dad? Should have been home by now.
Well, Wally, if I know your father, he's out chasing beaver.
Father loves beaver. Here on IBC, you'll love it.
It makes you feel like you're here at Christmas already. All right. Let's hear your final top commercial parody.
All right. Well, you know, first of all, I just want to put a plug in for a new sketch show that's on. They're going into their second season, called A Black Lady Sketch Show. And I haven't seen every episode of the first season, but everything I saw was just great. And I actually tried to see if they'd done any commercial sketches. I don't know if they have. If anybody knows if they have or haven't, send us a line. But check them out. I know that they're right in the middle of their second season now. So check your local listings. But my first top favorite one here easily could have been John Belushi's Little Chocolate Donuts. It's just a classic. Every time I watch that thing, I laugh. And you don't even have to remember what it's spoofing, really. That's what I think sets a lot of these apart is you didn't even have to know what the original ad campaign was to really enjoy them, to laugh at just the craziness of it. Because as we said at the beginning, crazy products is evergreen. It's always going to be a part of our lives, and we're always going to want to make fun of them. But my first favorite, you mentioned this group before, SCTV. It's a classic sketch that I remember, and it stars, and I believe it was written by Eugene Levy, called The Phone Company. Anyway, let's check out Eugene Levy from SCTV in a commercial for The Phone Company.
Now, can you just get some rest? We'll go over these contracts a little later.
Okay, Mr. Evans.
It's been a long trip, and you're tired. You don't like to be away from the family. You're wondering if your wife made it home safely from the airport. Why not give her a call? You'll feel better, and so will she.
Hello.
Hi, honey.
Yeah, we're all right. How's your flight?
Oh, the trip was fine, honey. No, nothing important. Just checking on you and the kids. I'm a little tired. Yeah, I love you too, honey. Bye-bye.
You know, your loved ones are only seconds away, and a long-distance call will let them know you love them and that you're thinking of them.
Granny! Hi, it's me, Kenny! Poopy! Yes, that's right, how are you?
What about your sister in Florida? Was that the flu she had last month or something more?
Hi, sis. Are you okay? Oh, no. I just felt like calling.
And your Uncle Leo. How's that bad heart of his? I hope it's not too late.
Operator, what do you mean you can't get through? The man has a bad heart!
And your wife. I hope things are still okay there.
Honey? Hey again. Everything's still okay? Look, I'll have to call you back.
And when was the last time you talked to your cousin Phil in Detroit?
Phil! Kenny! Kenny!
And Art Fisher. He was your closest friend in high school.
When did he move?
Well, Ken, all rested up. I thought we'd have a little supper, and then we'll go over those...
Will you leave me alone? Can't you see I'm on the phone? This is family!
Long distance.
Yes!
Bringing you and your loved ones together.
Who are you?
We're your phone company, giving you a chance to show you care and a chance to share your money with us.
Good stuff.
Indeed. And of course, every time we have a new class, we're going to list it right here on our YouTube page, and we're going to list it right here on Facebook and on our website, which is theimprovtrick.com.
Don't forget the .com.
Yeah, if you don't put .com or put www, you're never going to find it.
No.
Thanks for watching this on YouTube. Don't forget to subscribe and to like all of our videos. That way you won't miss one, and you'll always know when the next Sketch In or Sketch House class is taking place.
Don't like it, love it.
Thanks a lot, everybody. Have a great rest of your weekend.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.
In the clumsy television broadcasting system. When you hear the musical note, will somebody call me up and tell me what time it is? Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Lovely evening, isn't it? Wheel your mother-in-law close to the radio, because this is the Guzzler's Gin program. Have you tried Guzzler's? It comes in two sizes, the college size and the jumbo elephant size. With Guzzler's, there's no bad taste, no bad... No bad taste, no after effect, no upsetting the nerves, just a nice, smooth drink. Pour a little in your glass and drink it right down, but be sure and ask for Guzzler's Gin, a nice, smooth drink. Guzzler's Gin, friend. Drink a little after dinner. Drink some before, you won't have to eat any dinner. I'll be back in a moment with more from our sponsors. In the meantime, here is our guest star of the evening, Mr. Sapini. J. Newton Numbskull, Doctor of Poetry. Thank you. My first poem. Greetings. My first poem, Algae. Algae saw bear, the bear saw algae. The bear was bulgy, the bulge was algae. And now back to our announcer and more from our sponsors, Guzzler's Gin. Thank you, Nudie, thank you. This is a Guzzler's Gin program you're looking at. Have you tried Guzzler's? It comes in two sizes. Get the college size. One bottle and a class for yourself. With Guzzler's, there's no bad taste, no after effect, no upsetting the nerves. Just a nice, smooth drink. Pour a little in your glass. There goes my nails. Pour a little in your glass and drink it right down, but be sure and ask for Guzzler's Gin, a nice, smooth drink. Oh, why can't I get an oatmeal program? Guzzler's, a nice, smooth drink. It comes in two sizes. Now back to our guest star, J. Newton Numbskull. Thank you, you drunken tramp, you. My next poem. Put 15 cents on number four. My next poem, The Garters. I bought my girl some garters at the local 5 and 10. She gave them to her mother. That's the last I'll see of them. And now back to our announcer who will sign off the Guzzler's Gin program. This right Guzzler's, it comes in 29 sizes. With Guzzler's, you don't need a chaser. Nothing could catch you. Save money. Get the jumbo elephant size. Only 25 cents a quart. Return the bottle and get your 15 cents back. Smooth. Thought it was my tongue hanging out. Pour a little in your glass. Pour a little in your glass. I'll get rid of it somehow. Pour a little in your glass and drink it right down.